Well, good morning and welcome to First Baptist Church of Jewett, Texas. We worship each Sunday at 11 o'clock here at 509 West Division Street. I hope that you can come and join us in person. I do want to remind you of a couple of things. One is we are publishing our worship service each week. Also, at 9:45 each Sunday, we are publishing our adult small group Bible study, the same Bible study that we would have in Sunday school. Also, all of our Sunday school classes are meeting each week at 9:45. If you've never attended one of our services, let me be the first to invite you to come and be our guest. We hope that you can join us. Let us know if there's anything we can pray for you about, anything that we can do for you or your family. May God bless you, and I trust that you'll enjoy our worship service.
What does it mean to be saved? Isn't it more than just a prayer? More than just a way to heaven? What does it mean to be in its likeness? Know that we have a purpose. To be salt and light in the world, and the world. To be salt and light in the world. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so. Oh, that the church would arise, that we would see with Jesus' eyes, we could show the world heaven. Show what it means to be His, to be formed in His likeness. Show them they have a purpose. To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so.
Sing, I am redeemed.
I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed, 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 I am redeemed.
To be salt and light.
To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world. To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world. To be salt and light in the world, in the world, in the world, in the world, in the world. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Rise up, rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, say so, say so, say so.
Amen. If you would remain standing for the reading from God's word.
And now, little children, abide in him, that when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who practices righteousness is born of him. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself, just as he is pure.
Is have paid my
yes.
This I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond measure is unto each day what he deserves. Loving me is part of pain and pleasure. Mingling toil with ease and rest. Every day the Lord himself is healing with a special mercy for each child. All my cares he gladly bears and cheers me. He whose name is Counselor and Prophet. The protection of his trodden treasure is a charge that on himself he laid. As your days, your strength shall be in measure. This the pledge to me he made. Help me then in every tribulation. So to trust your promise as a Lord, that I lose on faith's sweet consolation, offered me within your holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble meet me, and to take us from my Father's hand. One by one, the days and moments fleeting, till I reach the promised land.
So much. If you have your Bibles, I'd like for you to look with me to the book of Luke. Book of Luke, chapter 15. Looks like each week we continue to increase in our numbers as people began to come back. And I've got a good crowd here on this Father's Day. So glad that you could come and be with us in worship this morning. And just continue to pray for those who are not able to come just yet. We still understand that. And we want to continue to keep our church lifted up in prayer during this time in our lives. We're going to look this morning at the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 15. We're going to focus on verses 11 through 32. You know, I don't think that there's a father in this building who would not give their very life for one of their children if they were called on to do so. It is, I believe, every father's heart's desire to see the very best for their kids, and they want them to come up and to do well in life. And for those of us who are Christian dads and Christian fathers, of course, I don't know about you, but it was my heart's desire. I couldn't wait until my children came of age and began to understand the gospel. And then when they put their faith and their trust in Christ, what an exciting day it was. And of course, for me, and being a pastor, having that opportunity to baptize my own kids, that was exciting times in my life. I was just the other day digging through some records for something we were doing, and I realized that I still have my youngest daughter who we're going to see. I still had her baptism certificate, you know, and I read that, and it just, again, it was just I don't know how to describe that feeling to know and remember back in that time when she gave her life to Christ and when she followed through with baptism. And we're going to take her baptism certificate very soon. But as a dad, I just wanted the very best for my kids. And I believe that all of our fathers here feel pretty much the same way. I would think that all the fathers and mothers that are here want the very best for their children, no doubt. You know, it's amazing at the stages of life that we go in as we're growing up as kids. And I think I can relate to each one of these stages, but somebody put it this way. Someone said that at age 4, we explained, my dad can do anything. He's Superman. I mean, there's nothing that my dad can't do, right? At age 7, we say, my dad knows a lot. By age 12, we're saying, oh, well, we can't expect dad to know everything. At the age of 14, we say, my dad is hopelessly out of date and old-fashioned. By the time we reach 21 years of age, we're saying, what should I expect? He just doesn't understand. At age 25, we begin to say, my dad knows a little bit, but not too much. By the age of 30, I need to find out what dad thinks. At age 40, we ask, what would dad have thought? And by the time we hit 50, we're saying, my dad knew everything. And then, of course, by the time we reach age of 60, we're saying, oh, I wish my dad were here now. You know, this morning, as we look at this passage, I think we see a story that's kind of a sad story, really, about a man who lost both of his kids, or at least for a season. And God worked through those circumstances, though, and it's quite an amazing story that the Lord Jesus tells us in the way of a parable. And I've titled the message this morning, The Heart of a Father, The Heart of a Father. Would you stand with me in honor of reading God's Word as we look at Luke chapter 15, beginning with verse 11. The Bible says, then he said, a certain man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in the land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and he joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine or pigs. He would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger?
I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and he came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, Bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring out the fatted calf and here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Now his older son was in the field, and he came and he drew near the house. He heard music and dancing, so he called one of the servants, and he asked what these things meant. And he said to him, Your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry and would not go in. Therefore his father came out and he pleaded with him. So he answered and he said to his father, Lo, these many years I have been serving you. I never transgressed your commandment at any time, and yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you killed the fatted calf for him. And he said to him, Son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. Would you pray with me? Father, I pray that you'd bless in the preaching, the reading of your word today. God, I pray that you'd move in the power of your Holy Spirit in this place. Lord, that every person under the sound of my voice would hear a word from heaven. And I pray, God, even though that I'm preaching a Father's Day message, Lord, that the ladies that are here would be impacted as well. And Lord, I pray that you would teach us something new today. And Lord, I pray that we would not leave the scene. God, we'd be more committed than ever to our families and to you. And Lord, I pray that if there's someone here that's lost, that Lord, they'd understand their need for a Savior and be saved today. For it's in Christ's name that I pray. Amen and amen. And you can be seated. Well, what can we learn from this story of what we call the prodigal son? Well, I think that there are a lot of angles that we can take and a lot of things that we can look at. But I primarily want to look at the father in his heart and the kind of man that he was. You know, I think that as we look at the story, we see the heart of a father, and we see a father that we could probably very easily model our lives after as dads, because he was a giving father. In verse 12, the Bible says, Then the younger said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. Who did he divide to? He divided to his younger son, but also to the elder son as well. Now, this passage doesn't say anything about mom, but it's reasonable to assume that mom was still around somewhere. She's just not mentioned here. So we have a husband and a wife who are working together, who are raising the family, but they gave these two boys life. And it would seem that they gave them a pretty good life as well. I mean, after all, he did have goods to divide between the two boys. So there was an inheritance for them. We have the elder son who does not understand forgiveness, obviously. He's a lot, if you will. We have in the elder son really a picture of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He was one that lived by the law. I mean, he even told his dad, he pointed it out to his dad. He said, look, I've never violated any of your commands. I've never done anything that would cross you. However, he doesn't even realize, but in the way that he's acting and his attitude toward his dad when he got angry here at the very end was disrespectful to his father. But we find that he was more like the Sadducees and the Pharisees. He was a legalistic young man. Folks, he probably wanted his dad to stone his brother to death. And the reality is this, that under the law in the Old Testament, his father had every right to put his son to death. And that was probably what the older son thought his dad would ultimately have to do to his younger brother. We have the elder brother, and then there's the younger son. You know the story. What did he do? He took the money, he went out and he invested the money, he made some wise decisions, right? No. Like happens so many times, and young people, don't take this wrongly, but sometimes when you put a lot of money into the hands of someone who's young, it's not always used in the wisest way. And that was certainly true. Yes, right, Brandon. And that's usually, that was especially true in this case, in the story that Jesus told. He took the money, and what? He ran. He left home. He got out of Dodge. Why did he do that? Because he looked on the other side of the fence, and he saw that the grass looked a little greener over there, and he decided, apparently, you know what? I'm tired of everybody telling me what to do. I'm just going to leave home, and I'm going to live life like I want to live life. I'm going to party hardy, and that's what he did. As a matter of fact, his brother already knew. He'd already heard about the way his brother was living. I'm sure the dad knew this as well. But he'd been out spending money on prostitutes. I'm sure that he blew all his money on his friends. But where did that leave him? When he was down and out, there wasn't anybody to be found. I'm sure he went up and down the streets of all those places where he went to party, knocking on doors, looking for help. But when they found out he didn't have anything to give them, there wasn't anything there for him. So we find the younger son starving to death. Literally, he's starving now. You know, when the chips were down, there was no one there for him. So we have the younger son now who is, he's down and out. He doesn't have anywhere to go. But yet we find that he finds forgiveness and that he is restored back in the family, which leads me to the father, who, folks, as we look to this father, his love for both boys were equal and constant. He loved the one who stayed, but folks, his love never diminished for the one who left. He loved both of his boys, and he loved them equally. According to the Old Testament, when there were two sons, the firstborn was to get what? Two-thirds of the inheritance. He received a double portion. But the youngest son was to get one-third. When we're told that they divided the inheritance, that's what took place. The older son got two-thirds of the inheritance. The younger son got a third of those of the inheritance. So the father made provision for his children, and he even had inheritance to give them. He was a giver to both his boys. He provided food. He provided housing. He provided clothing. And these are basic things, but I think every dad wants to provide that for them family. He was not only a good provider, but he gave his children time. I mean, look, the younger son, when the chips were down and he couldn't find anywhere else to go, what did he do? He decided to go back home. You know what? I think that he knew that his dad would take care of him still. Now, he may not have known the extent of it, but he didn't feel like his dad would turn him away. He didn't keep trying to go out in the world and find help. When he got down to his last penny, he decided, you know what, the best thing I can do is go back to dad. And dad will help me with this situation. I believe that he felt that way. So the dad was a good provider, and he provided his children, he provided them with time. He gave of his time. You know, I understand as I look at all the stats that the divorce rate in America is higher than the marriage rate. In other words, there are more people being divorced than there are people being married in our country today. And the sad part about all of that is the statistics show that it's true among Christians as well. But you know, children need their dads. Children need their fathers in the home. There are a lot of single-parent moms out there who are having to take care of their kids, and they're having to be daddy and mama at the same time, and we need to pray for them. And there are many of them that do it, and they do it well. But it's hard. It's hard for that to happen. But make no mistake about it, still, when we have an intact family, when we have a husband and we have a wife who is raising their children up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, the percentage of their success, the stats would show goes out the ceiling as far as them succeeding in life and making it in life. They're going to grow up well-balanced and able to adapt and able to provide for themselves in this world. As we look out across our country today, folks, I want to tell you, if you haven't heard this, the problem that we have in America today is, yes, we've become a godless country, no doubt about it. Yes, we have sin in our country, make no doubt about it, but our homes have been destroyed. Our homes have been wrecked. And a lot of the problems that we see today is that we have so many who have problems with authority. They have no authority in the home, and they have no respect for those who are older. And it's because we have fewer and fewer intact homes in our country. And that needs to change. And until that does change, we're going to continue to go downhill as a nation. We need to pray for our country. We need to pray for our families. And listen, church, don't take it for granted. Pray for the families that are still intact in our church. And by all means, help those who don't have intact families. Come around them. Some of you could be surrogate dads for somebody. I mean, come in, enter into another person's life and help them with their situation when there's a single parent trying to raise children in the home. A large part of our society, though, is single-parent homes, but a child needs both for stability. Dads, your sons and daughters, they need you. They need your time. They need you to be there for them. Fathers need to teach their children to love and to respect their mothers, and they need to see it in the way that you treat your wife in the home. The Bible makes it very clear that we are to love our wives as Christ loved the church. And I believe that when the children see that in their father, then they will follow suit. Not always the way that we think they should, but the chances are far greater that they will if they see that in the home. Fathers need to be there to give spiritual direction in the family as well. You know, I've heard many men talk about this, and they say, well, that's my wife takes the kids to church, or my wife takes the kids to Sunday school. Let me tell you something. As we look at the Scripture, that is the man's role. It is the man's role to lead his family spiritually. It is not the wife's role. Now, listen to me, ladies, if that's where you are, that's what you're doing, don't stop. But I'm telling you, scripturally speaking, in God's order, He's placed the man at the head of the home to lead the home spiritually. So he needs to be leading his children in prayer and in Bible study and reading the Word of God. Just for a moment, look with me at Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians 6, beginning with verse 1. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Ephesian church, he talks about the relationship between the children and their parents. He says, chapter 6, verse 1, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Kids, did you hear that? Obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment, with promise that it may be well with you. You may live long on the earth. Children, young people, you want to know how to live a long life? Honor your father and your mother. That's a promise right there that you will. And you fathers, listen, dads, and you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up how? Bring them up in the training, in the admonition of worldly things? No, the Lord, in the Lord. So we need to be teaching our children. Grandpas need to be teaching their children and their grandkids too. I mean, it doesn't stop there. We're to bring them up in the nurture in the admonition of the Lord. As dads, we are to lead our families in prayer and in Bible study. One of the things we do around our home today is that we, every chance we get, we try to gather around the dinner table at dinner time. Dinner is not At 12 on Sunday, by the way. It's at 6 each day. I know there's a big argument about that. But anyways, dinner, we gather around the table. We still try to gather around the table, not with the TV on, not with our, it's a rule we don't even bring. Well, we started bringing our phones because we have our Bible on the phone. That's the only reason. But we come together, and we started, I came across an article written not too long ago about a guy that was doing this, and we're doing it now, but we're reading through Psalms together. So every day, a different person at the table takes one of the Psalms and reads it, and we're just going in order reading it. And then we talk about the Psalm, and then we go around the table, and each person gets to pray. And then the person that read the Psalm kind of tries to incorporate that into their prayer. The only reason I'm telling you that is maybe that's something that you could think about doing. But I just want you to know that it's just been my experience that it's been one of the most joyful times in our home. As we come together and we talk about God's Word and we pray together. Yeah, but dads need to be leading the way. Dads need to be leading their family to church. You know, when my children were growing up, I always hoped and prayed that they wanted to go to church. But you know what? There were times that they didn't want to go to church. Matter of fact, I was the preacher, and there were times I didn't want to go to church. But I want you to know something. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And whether we feel like it or not, we're going to be at the Lord's house. Why? Because one, God has commanded it so that we come together. We not forsake the assembling of ourselves together. But folks, if my family is going to survive, it's going to be because we come together as God's people. If the church is going to survive, it's going to be because we come together as God's people. And we draw strength from that. And it helps our family unit. And I can go on and on and on in that area. But I want you to know something. I don't know about you, but my kids had no choice. As long as I was paying the bills, as long as they were living under my roof, church was not an option. They were always there. It had to be. And I know people say, well, I don't want to do that with my kids. You make them go to school. You make them brush their teeth. You tell them what time they have to go to bed. Are you kidding me? You mean you're not going to tell them they must come to church? What's going to be more important? Bring them to the house. Bring them to Bible study. I think it's vitally important that we lead, but that we, and not just bring them and drop them off, but that we're there with them. Bring them to church. You see, your children know if your relationship with Jesus Christ is real or not because they watch you. They know what you do. And by the way, I've known people that are so overbearing with their kids and they make them go to church, but they live like the devil the rest of the week. And folks, that is so discouraging to a child. What we profess on Sunday, dads, by all means, live it out every day. And by the way, a lot of our teaching as dads is in day-to-day life. There's so many things in life that we do that we can talk about with God's Word as we teach them how to mow the lawn, how to do repairs on cars. As we talk about all these things, we can make some spiritual application and do teaching day to day with our children. But I want you to know something. When the umbilical cord is cut, your child begins a journey away from dependency on you. And most of you, as I look out here, you're old enough to know this, and you know it's absolutely true. 18 years goes by like that, and they're gone. So make every moment count, because before you know it, they will be on their own. I remember when my first child, Amanda, took off to college, and it was an emotional time for us as she left home. But I also remember thinking a week out, 2 weeks out, 3 weeks out, oh my, I don't know that I told her about this. Or I don't know if I taught her this. And I began to realize it's too late for that. She's gone. So take advantage of those first 18 years that you have with your children to teach them. Because before you know it, they're going to be out of the house, they're going to be on their own. Someone wrote, please walk a little slower, Daddy. If you go and leave me, I may not find the way. Make your steps shorter so I can keep in stride. I want my friends to see me walking by your side. Walk a little straighter, Daddy, for I want the world to see that my daddy is the greatest, just like I want to be. Whenever I'm in trouble, I don't know what to do. I want everyone to see that I'm walking just like you. The prodigal son not only had an earthly father, not only had a godly daddy, but he also understood that he had a heavenly father. In verse 18 in our text, the Bible says, I will arise, I will go to my father, and I will say to him, what? Father, I have sinned against who? Against heaven and before you. So he had a heavenly father that he could call out to. What did he do? He realized he'd messed up. He realized that he had sinned against heaven and against his father. You know, the Bible tells us that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Not a one of us are perfect. We all sin, probably daily. The Bible also tells us that the wages of those sins is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. He realized that he'd sinned, but he repented as a result of that realization. And over in 1 John it says, if we confess our sins, what? He is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We have that kind of Father, a heavenly Father, that we can come to for forgiveness. The prodigal's father was a giving father. He was a giving father. But notice with me also that he was a compassionate father. A compassionate father. Look at verse 20. And he arose, that is the prodigal son, and he came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, the father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell and kissed him on his neck and kissed him. Oh, I'm telling you folks, this father missed his son. Some of you are feeling it right now. Some of you are feeling it. Hey, you know, Marsh and I moved out here 4 years ago so we could be closer to our kids. And it still seems like I don't see my son any more than I did when I lived in Georgia. And I want to be with him. I think this father had a prodigal son. He wanted to be with him. He wanted him to come back home. He longed for that day to see his son again. I believe the father had never stopped looking, never stopped hoping, never stopped praying that one day my boy's going to come back. Have you ever had anybody come over unexpectedly that you hadn't seen in a long, long time? And sometimes that's not good. But it's somebody you really like. You hadn't seen them in a long, long time, maybe even a relative. And man, it's just like, wow. I hadn't seen you. Oh, I was just thinking about you the other day. And here you come. You show up. You know what that feeling's like when somebody comes, you really, really want to see them. You hadn't seen them in a long time. They come and you begin to fellowship together. I think that when he saw his son coming, he thought, he's really coming home. He's really coming back. I'm sure he got excited. He was overwhelmed with emotion and the love that he had for his son. I'm sure he looked down that long road leading from his house and he saw his son. And the Bible says that he ran to where his son was. He didn't wait on him to come. Isn't that a beautiful picture of who God is? God didn't wait on us. He came to where we are. He came to us. Why? Because the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his son. Listen, this father loved his boy. It's interesting that when we look at these verses in verse 19, it says, and the boy, when he came to himself, back in verse 18, he says, Father, he began to rehearse what he was going to tell his dad. He says, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer to be worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. Notice that last line. Make me like one of your hired servants. In other words, I don't expect you to restore me, but just let me work for you. Let me come and be one of your employees. But then when you drop down to verse 21, and the son said to him, remember, he's been rehearsing this. He's going home. You know what that's like? He was thinking through, what am I going to tell Dad? So he's got his line worked out. He's worked it out in his mind. He says, Father, I have sinned against heaven, and in your sight am no longer to be worthy to be called your son. And guess what? He couldn't get out the part where he said, let me be one of your hired servants. His daddy cut him off. And he said, but the father said to his servants, bring the best robe. He cut him off. He never let him finish that thing that he had rehearsed. I think the dad knew where he was going with this whole train of thought. And Dad jumps in and stops him short of that. It's almost like Dad is saying, oh, no, you're still my boy. You're still my son. Dad, there's no way I'm going to make you like one of my hired servants. You are still one of my boys. Now, a lot of people take this passage to look at it and make a salvation message out of this. I want you to know something. We're talking about a father who already had a son, and he never stopped being a son. This is not in its truest sense a salvation theme or a salvation message here. This is about restoration. This is about a boy who never stopped being a son, and his father said, I'm going to restore you. Because you have come back. He came back and he asked for forgiveness, and his dad was going to put him back where, guess, he was going to put him back where he left off. Isn't that the way God is? You know, we come to Christ, we come for salvation, we accept Christ as our Savior, and then somewhere along the way we get off the path and we're not walking like we should walk, we're not doing the kind of things that we should do, and guess what happens? We come to ourselves. And by the way, you can't continue on that path if you belong to God. God will hammer you. God will chastise you. The Bible says that God chastens those whom He loves. Guess what happens? We repent of our sin. And then you know what the Father does? He lifts us up. He dusts us off. And He puts us right back where we left off. Because that's the kind of dad that we have. That's the kind of father that we have. That's the kind of father that these boys had. Like this father, our heavenly Father loves us unconditionally. And as I look at this passage, I know we're talking about the two sons, but someone has suggested that there's a third son involved here. The third son is telling the story. It's the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. He left home. Jesus did. And He came to this earth not to be a prodigal son, not to live in disobedience, but as you read through the Gospel of John, Jesus reminds everybody He's around over and over again, I'm only doing what my Father told me to do. I'm only doing what I see Him doing. I'm following Him. And He came for a completely selfish or selfless reason here to this earth. And that was to die for your sin and for mine. The Lord Jesus Christ, the third son in this picture, if you will. He loved His Father. In the Bible tells us this, the Father loves the Son and has given all things into His hand. He who believes in the Son, that is Jesus, has everlasting life. And he who does not believe in the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. I want you to know something. God loves you this morning, and He desires a relationship with you through His Son, Jesus Christ. He's a giving Father, this Father that we're talking about, our Heavenly Father. He's a compassionate Father. The Father in our story, our Heavenly Father, He's a compassionate Father. But I want you to notice also that He's a forgiving Father. We find in our story that He treated His son as royalty. He came home in rags, but what did his dad do? He placed on him, first of all, the best robe. Now, mind you, he's been wallowing with pigs. He's been in the pig pen. Now, I know around here we have a lot of chicken houses, but in Georgia we got a lot of pig pens. And growing up, I still remember helping my granddad taking care of the pigs and a lot of things that we did that I wouldn't even talk about that we did with pigs. But folks, I promise you, When you went back home, you didn't smell like you did when you went out to work with pigs. You smelled like pigs, and it was rank. I still remember going to my aunt's house, my Aunt Linda. Some of y'all have met her, and they raised hogs, and I helped her one week while her husband was away. I'd never seen so many flies in all my life. Stink. You could not, when you came home, you had to undress at the door. You wouldn't dare go in the house. I'm trying to give you a picture of the prodigal son. He lived with the pigs. He ate with the pigs. This was so against Jewish cut, Jews to have nothing to do with pork or with the pigs. And yet he comes home. He's been out in the muck, in the mire, if you will, in the sin of this world. And what does his daddy do? His daddy runs to him, arms open wide. Oh, I'm sure the smell was horrendous. And he grabs his boy, kisses him on the neck. You know what he does? Cleans him up. Put on the best robe. Get him the good robe, the clean robe. I can't help but believe that there was a bath somewhere in there. He gave him the good robe. He gave him the ring. And by the way, for you and I today, we've got the down payment. We have the earnest of spirit. We have the ring on our finger. We were saved. We're being saved. But thank God one day we'll be saved when Jesus Christ comes to take his church home. He's just given us the down payment, the deposit, the Spirit of God that lives in us. The Father slid the signet ring on it, which meant he's a part of this family. He's a part of the family. And then he put shoes on his feet. I'm sure he didn't have any shoes on, Brandon. A robe. He gave him a ring. He put shoes on his feet. He restored him. Oh, folks, listen, in this imagery, in this picture that we have the perfect picture of what it means to know Jesus Christ as our Savior. And one day we're going to go home to be with the Lord, and we will be saved forevermore. Listen, like this son, you never stop being a son. You may wander away. You may go away from what God wants you to do in life. But when we come home, we know that he will clean us up and put us back on the right path. For the Christian, this is good news, because we know that our Father holds us in the palm of his hand. The Bible says, Jesus said, that no one will ever pluck them from my Father's hand. We belong to him. In conclusion this morning, as fathers, we should be giving. We should be compassionate. And we need to be forgiving, just as this Father forgave his Son. After all, our Heavenly Father has forgiven us. Even when we were at our worst, he forgives us, and he will restore us. Our Heavenly Father is our model of what a perfect Father should be. And he's one that we can look to, that we can learn from. He would teach us how we need to raise our children and how we're to conduct ourselves in this world. Follow him in his teachings, and you'll be the best father a child could ever need. In many ways, all of us have failed as fathers. We're not perfect. But I know my Heavenly Father will take care of that. He'll fill in the gaps, and he will help. You know, as I look back over the years that Marcia and I had our three children at home, so many things now, if I could do it all over again, I would. That's okay. We're all broken. God will be there for them just like he was for us. He will help them in the struggles that they face in life. I want you to know something. God loves you. He loves you with an everlasting love. And you may be sitting here this morning and you feel like, you know what? I blew it. I've blown it big time. It's never too late. It's never too late. Go and find that wayward child. Pray for them. Encourage them. If you need to apologize, apologize to them, whatever it might take. But more than anything, let them see Christ in you and be consistent and trust God with all the rest. Amen? Amen. Amen. Would you bow your heads with me? Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Christians are praying. It could be this morning that you just want to come and bring your family and pray with your family today. Make a commitment to them to be the spiritual leader in your home that you need to be.
Well, once again, we thank you for joining us at First Baptist Church Online. I trust that you've enjoyed our service this morning. Perhaps there was something that was said this morning. Perhaps God spoke to you through the message today. It could be that you're there and for the first time you realize that you need to put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. You see, the Bible makes it very clear that God loves us. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life." But the same Bible also teaches us that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We know that God hates sin, and as a matter of fact, the Bible says that God will judge sin. He puts it this way over in the book of Deuteronomy: God will in no wise clear the guilty. So we have a problem with our relationship with God. But God solved that problem in the person of his son, Jesus Christ. Well, who is Jesus? Well, the Bible tells us that he was virgin born. He lived among us for 33 and a half years, performed a lot of miracles, did a lot of marvelous things. He loved people, but he never sinned at all in his lifetime. And yet, he went to the cross, died on the cross for your sins and for mine, for sins that he did not commit. He was willing to do that for you and me. He was willing to pay the price in our place. The Bible says, after 3 days, Jesus rose from the dead, was seen by many. Then after 40 days, he ascended back to the right hand of the Father. And what I want you to know this morning is he desires a relationship with you. Well, how can you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? Well, the Bible says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So this morning, right where you are, wherever you find yourself listening to this message, you could pray and you could put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. This morning, I want to pray for you, and maybe you would have your, it is your desire, put your faith and trust in Christ, and I'll pray a prayer. Maybe you want to follow along with that prayer, and for the first time, put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, we thank you for the service today, and Lord, those who are listening by online, on Facebook, or through YouTube, I pray, God, that you would just meet their needs right where they are. Lord, if there's someone under the sound of my voice today that does not know you as Lord and Savior, I pray that you would hear their prayer of salvation today. Friend, if it is your desire to put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, would you pray this prayer along with me? Mean it in your heart. Lord Jesus, I believe that you died on the sin. You died on the cross for my sin, that you rose from the dead and you're alive today. Lord Jesus, forgive me of all my sin. Come into my heart and life and be my Lord and Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Now help me to live for you. If you prayed that prayer, let me be the first to congratulate you and welcome you to the family of God. We'd love to hear from you. On the bottom of your screen, you'll see that there's an email address, prayer@fbcjewett.org. You can send us an email or you can call us at 903-626-5571. That's 903-626-5571. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to share with you some more information about how you can walk with God and have the kind of relationship with the Lord that he desires to have with you. God bless you, and I hope you have a wonderful week.